morning students. In the last class we have just discussed about magnetic properties of d block elements, then formation of colored ions, and then lastly we have discussed about formation of complexes. Okay, now in this class I will just discuss about catalytic properties shown by the d block elements. Catalytic properties shown by the d block elements. So here generally d block elements are good catalyst in inorganic and organic reactions. So reasons for the catalytic behavior will be, first one, the variable, they show variable oxidation state, or variable can also be called as multiple oxidation state because of number of unpaired electrons, s and d electrons available for bonding. So as they show variable oxidation state, here they can form, because of this variable oxidation state, these d block elements can form several intermediate compounds, intermediate compounds are usually unstable compounds of lower energy or higher energy, so that more number of products can be formed and rate of the reaction is faster. Second reason for the catalytic properties will be that finely divided metal is having large surface area. Finely divided metal has larger surface area, so that more number of molecules can be, reactant molecules can be adsorbed on the surface of the catalyst and form the products. Third reason for the catalytic properties will be that presence of empty d orbitals. Presence of empty d orbitals. This also facilitate adsorption of more and more molecules in the vacant d orbitals to form the products. So finely divided metal has got the higher surface area, so that reactant molecules can be easily adsorbed on the surface of the catalyst to form the bonds with the reactant molecules. Catalyst forms bonds with the reactant molecules. It is involved in the reaction, and at the end of the reaction it will be regenerated. Now examples of d block elements used as catalyst will be like this. First one, V2O5 is used in contact process. V2O5 is used in the formation of sulfuric acid by contact process. Then second one, finely divided Fe or MO is used in Haber's process of formation of ammonia. Then third one, nickel, palladium and platinum are used as the catalyst in hydrogenation of oils. Okay, then fourth one, iron 3, that is Fe in the +3 oxidation state, catalyzes reaction between iodide and persulfate ions to form the products. Then fifth one, rhodium complex PH3P thrice RHCl, that is triphosphine rhodium chloride. This catalyst is called as Wilkinson catalyst, and this is used in the manufacture of or hydrogenation of alkanes. So rhodium complex, that is triphosphine rhodium chloride, this complex is called as Wilkinson catalyst, and this catalyst is used in the hydrogenation of alkene. Then sixth one, PDCl2 is used in the, or the reagent PDCl2 is called as Weber's process reagent, and this is used in the conversion of or oxidation of ethane to ethanol. Okay, then Next, seventh catalyst, Ziegler-Natta catalyst, combination of TiCl4 and AlCH3 thrice, that is tetrachlorotitanium and trimethyl aluminium. This compound is called as Ziegler-Natta catalyst, and this is used in the manufacture of polythene, that is polymerization of ethene. We are using Ziegler-Natta catalyst. And lastly, the compound called as PD in BaSO4, this compound is called as Lindlar's catalyst, and this Lindlar's catalyst is used in the oxidation of or conversion of reduction of acetyl chlorides to aldehydes CHO group. These are the some examples which are used as catalyst in the D block elements. Now next, move for next property, that is interstitial compound formation. Next property exhibited by D block elements is interstitial compound formation. So here interstitial compounds means small non-metal atoms like hydrogen, carbon, boron, nitrogen and helium are trapped in between the interstitial sites of crystal of the metal. That means, so I will just draw the crystal lattice here. So the metal lattice will be like this. In this, there will be in the interstitial sites, that is in between the lattice sites, small atoms like hydrogen, carbon, boron, nitrogen and helium will be trapped inside the metals as interstitial compounds. So here, if the hydrogen is associated with the compound, then the resulting compounds formed by hydrogen will be hydrides, carbon will be carbides, then boron will be borides, nitrogen will be nitrides, and helium will be halides. Okay, this halides is different from HALIDE, halide X group. Okay, now here these compounds are also called as non-stoichiometric compounds. And when these are called as non-stoichiometric compounds, here the compounds like oxygen, sulfur, cellarium and tellurium are trapped inside the crystal lattice of the metal, then the resulting compounds are called as non-stoichiometric compounds. Why they are called as non-stoichiometric compounds? So I will write the reason here. In this chemical composition, so here they are called as non-stoichiometric compounds because formulae of these compounds do not correspond to normal oxidation state. Okay, so because of this reason they are called as non-stoichiometric compound, that is because of their nature and chemical composition is not as per the regular formula. Chemical composition is not as per the regular formula, it will be odd like that. Okay, examples in this non-stoichiometric will be TiC, TiN, then VH.56, then TiH.1.7, VSC, then FeO, then MnO4, N, then Fe3HR, some of the examples of interstitial compounds formed by the D block elements. Then what will be the properties of these interstitial compounds? Why they are called as so? So why they are called as so, just I have explained you. What is the reason? Here chemical composition will not be corresponding to the regular general formula. They will be like any odd numbers. So see here, TIN means here oxidation state will be 3, in this oxidation state will be 4, in this oxidation state will be 3, like this. No regular oxidation state of the metal will be present in the non-stoichiometric compounds. So here, these properties are the properties of the non-interstitial compounds will be, properties will be, have high melting points than pure metals, then pure metals, first property, then they are retain metallic conductivity, retain metallic conductivity, then chemically inert and are rigid in nature. Some borides cross the diamond hardness. Okay, some borides will have diamond hardness. So these are the properties of interstitial compounds. Now in the interstitial compounds, some main examples will be steel and cast iron are the examples. Steel and cast iron are the examples of Fe and C, that is in between the Fe atoms, carbon atoms are trapped, so that we are forming the interstitial compounds as steel and cast iron. So okay, whereas so here these are hard, malleability, ductility decreases, but tenacity increases. Now last but one property of D block elements will be alloy formation. Last but one property, alloy formation. So what is an alloy? Alloy is a homogeneous solid mixture of metal with one or more metals or with non-metals. Okay, so the combination may be anyone. Alloy is a homogeneous solid mixture of metal, one metal with one or more metals or with non-metals. So here condition that they are going to join in such a way that, that means two metals are going to join such a way that radii difference between the two, radii difference is nearly 15%. That is, the atoms having radii difference 15% are going to join in the form of one metal is joined, so here also the same process is there. In the one metal is this one, and another in between the interstitial sites, the another metal will be present, so that there will be a formation of homogeneous mixture in the solution, and it is called as alloy. Okay, so here due to similarity in size, atoms of one atom can be easily take up positions in the crystal lattice of the another in the molten state and are miscible with each other, forming homogeneous solid solutions and smooth alloys on heating. Okay, now what will be the properties of these alloys? Going for the properties of the alloys. So generally harder, have high melting points than pure metals, then are more resistant, to heat, more resistant to corrosion and heat than the individual metals. So the best known alloy will be ferrous alloy. In this, Fe is combined with the elements like chromium, vanadium, then molybdenum, tungsten, and Mn will be of industrial importance. So some alloys which are of made up of non-metals are also having industrial importance, like brass is a combination of copper with zinc. Then bronze is a copper with tin. Then German silver is a combination of copper, silver and tin. Okay, these are the some examples of non-metals alloys, that is copper with the non-metal as alloys, and they are having industrial importance. So now we will move for oxo ions, oxides and oxocations of some D block elements. So here alloy formation, here I am going to end the properties of D block element. Next is oxides and oxo ions of oxides and oxoanions of D block elements. So generally, because of the property of variable oxidation state, D block elements are combining with oxygen to form oxides like MeMO, MO3, M2O5, M2O7, then MO4 or M2O4, O3, like this. So many oxides will be formed by the metal or 3D ions. Okay, so here they will be having all the metal oxides except scandium. Some properties I will give here, except scandium, which are ionic in nature. Okay, the highest oxidation state in the oxides coincide with the highest oxidation state in the oxide coincide with the group number, that is we can form the compounds as Se2O3, here scandium plus 3 to Mn2O7 with oxidation number plus 7. The highest known compounds of Fe will be Fe2O3. Okay, so this is the 7th group element, so that beyond 7th group there will be no higher oxides will be formed. Now next one, as the atomic number increases, oxidation ionic character goes on decreasing. So ionic character goes on decreasing. What character will be increased then? So with the increase of atomic number, we are just going to decrease the ionic character, so that covalent character goes on increasing. That is, some plus 2 oxidation state, plus 3 oxidation states will be ionic in nature, and the compounds formed by plus 3 greater than plus 3 oxidation states will be generally covalent in nature, and plus 2 plus 3 oxidation compound states will be generally basic in nature, and higher oxidation states beyond plus 5 will be generally acidic in nature. Okay, so I will give you some examples in the acidic, basic and then amphoteric nature oxides. Okay, so here in the oxides, in the plus 2 plus 3 oxidation state, basic oxides will be MO, M3O4, then M2O5 will be generally basic in nature. Oxides which are present in the oxidation state plus 2, minus 2, then minus 3 and minus 5, minus 2 will be generally, or metal oxidation state plus 2, plus 4 and plus 5 will be generally basic in nature. Whereas the oxides of some elements like CuO, Cr2O3, then MnO2 are generally amphoteric in nature. What is the meaning of amphoteric? So they will show both the behavior, that is, they are, in one case they will show acidic nature and in another case they will show basic nature. In this group we will include the another compound V2O5, okay? And the metals in the oxidation state, Mn2O7, MnO4 2 minus, like this, Cr2O7 2 minus, all are acidic in nature. Here I am going to end the properties of D block elements. In the next class we will move for the F block elements, that is inner transition elements, lanthanides and actinides. Thank you.